Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Katie Clark. And the first agenda item is to agree whether to take items 4 and 5 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence and a discussion about our work programme. Are we all agreed? Thank you. The next agenda item is the first in a short series of evidence-taking sessions on the spending priorities in the justice sector for 2022 to 2023, and I refer members to papers 1 to 3. And I welcome our panel of witnesses this morning, whom I'm delighted to see in person for a change. We have with us Mr. David Page, Deputy Chief Officer of Police Scotland, Mr. James Gray, Chief Financial Officer for Police Scotland, and Mr. Chris Brown, Acting Chief Executive and Accountable Officer of the Scottish Police Authority. And we very much appreciate the time that you've taken to join us this morning. I thank the witnesses for their written submissions, and these are available online. And I intend to allow about an hour and 15 minutes for questions and discussions. And just before we move to questions, I'd like to put on record on behalf of the committee our best wishes for Ms. Lynn Brown, Chief Executive at the Scottish Police Authority, and we're all wishing her a very speedy recovery. So please can I ask members to indicate which witness you're directing your remarks to, and we can then open the floor to other witnesses for comments. If other witnesses wish to respond to a question, please can I ask you to indicate to me or to the clerks that you want to come in, and I'll bring you in if time permits. If you're merely agreeing with what a witness is saying, that there's no need to intervene to say so. So we'll now move directly to questions, and please can members and our invited guests keep your questions and comments as succinct as possible. And I plan to structure the discussion around a series of broad themes. And I'd quite like to start off, if I may, by looking at budget requirements around that sort of return process from COVID, and in particular returning to sort of pre-COVID levels of working. And in the Police Scotland written submission, you specifically, or there was specific reference to the implications on the service arising from the anticipated increase in court delivery, including witness scheduling and the sort of broader summary justice reform. So I suppose in the context of budget scrutiny, I'm quite interested in how, if you can outline a little bit more detail on that, and what opportunities there might be to offset some of those costs. And I'm particularly thinking about the implications on police time, police officer time committed to court attendance. So I'll maybe address that question to maybe firstly Mr. Page and Mr. Gray.
I can start, convener, on that. So we are working closely with our operational colleagues to understand what the kind of future requirements are going to look like. But certainly we have got funding in this financial year for additional overtime costs, because that's generally what the cost is for policing, for officers who are abstracted from their duties to go to court. Now, we know that this is, that there's obviously the backlog, and that will have implications. So we're still working with the team to understand exactly what the financial impact will be. So we can't quantify it at this point, but it's something that we will be working on over the next number of months to get to a position where we set the budget next March. But you know, depending on the approach taken, the cost can vary significantly. Obviously, the time to actually attend in person is there's an awful lot more time involved in that, and evidence that could be provided, you know, through a system like, you know, an online platform would certainly reduce the financial implications for policing. But that's something that we're working with operational colleagues to understand what it will look like, and then we'll cost it. But I suppose fundamentally, from a cost perspective, that's the big difference, is around whether it's in person or whether it's online. Because obviously, as has happened in the past, and I'm sure will continue to happen, things move and change, and quite often officers may attend court and then you know they're not required, and that's time that's been lost by being abstracted from, whether they're in local policing or whether they're national services, to go and spend the time there to find out they're not required. Now, if it was an appointed time using an online mechanism, if it doesn't therefore happen, there's not as much time lost. So for me, I think that is the single biggest element. But as I say, I don't know yet what that will look like to be able to tell you what the financial implications will be, but they could be minimised by maximising the amount of online evidence rather than in person, I think.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if Mr. Brown or Mr. Page, you want to come in on that? No. Thank you for that. And I think that kind of what I'm thinking about in terms of post-COVID recovery as an opportunity for reform and using it as a platform perhaps for reform. And that kind of brings me on to issues around changing demand. So it's that balance between how we promote reform, but also in the context of changing demand on the police service. So if I can sort of touch on that for a moment, in the five-year financial planning report, you talk about changing demand arising from changing nature of crime, changing community expectations, community needs, and so on. And we recently visited the Scottish Crimes Campus and we had quite a helpful discussion around the sort of challenges of recruiting specialist staff, for example, in the context of tackling cybercrime. So I'm interested in, bearing that in mind, what might be the budgetary implications around changing demand, but the sort of specialist nature of some of that new demand and how that might impact on budgetary considerations.
I'll take that. Thanks, Convener. There's a number of considerations there. One is that we have to obviously operate within the budget that we have. Another one is that we're committed to maintaining the officer numbers at the moment. The workforce that we have has got a set of kind of inherited skills from the legacy forces that we have now. We are looking at changing the workforce mix, as the strategic workforce plan says, and a key component of that is creating additional capacity around those kind of key skills like cyber you're talking about. So there's a number of ways that we can get there. One is through the transformation program is and reform funding, which is absolutely critical to us. If we continue to get to reform funding, we can continue supported by capital to do transformational activity, which creates capacity and creates space for us to then recruit new specialists, if you like. The other way is changing the workforce mix. So if we have some of the cyber skills are, as you say, very specialist, but don't necessarily need a warranted card or a warranted power to kind of discharge the duties. So it might well be that it's rebalancing the workforce at this point so that we perhaps have more civilian staff with those types of skills rather than warranted officers, because you actually don't need the warranted officer in some of those key roles. The other side of it is a recognition of the marketplace at the moment, because these type of cyber skills are in massive demand across the UK, across the world, effectively. We need to think about growing our own, effectively. So this is things like apprenticeships, things about how we can attract people in, perhaps how we can do work with private sector to kind of have people coming in to us and going back out to them and things like that. So we've got to be innovative in the way that we're looking at recruiting these people, because it's a new area for us and we're going to have to develop some new skills. And ideally, we want them to stay with us for a while. What we don't want is people coming in to policing, kind of getting a cyber badge, if you like, and then leaving to get a salary that's two or three times greater than that. So there's a number of different factors around there, but transformation to create capacity and capability, which gives us money effectively, changing the workforce mix and different ways of kind of hiring people and trying to attract and retain people.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Thank you. I will hand over now to Rona Mackay just to look at a little bit around balancing the budget. I think you were interested in some exploring that.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. I think this question, maybe James, might be for you. Last year, the Scottish Government provided a cash injection in order to eliminate a structural deficit in the policing budget. I understand that the budget has now been balanced. So can I ask what steps you'll be taking, you know, given all the challenges that are presenting, to maintain that balanced budget going forward?
Yeah, thank you for the question, and that's absolutely correct. The deficit, the structural deficit, has been eliminated as a result of the uplift in funding, and we welcome that. You know, the ask that we had made last year that had been heard and had corrected the deficit. So we have a balanced position, and we have a 5-year financial plan, and that plan sets out a path to maintain that financial balance throughout the period, and therefore remain sustainable. I think there's a couple of things around that. The first one is that 87% or thereabouts of our budget is in payroll. It's in police officers and police staff. And given the size of the organisation, it means that we have over £1 billion worth of people in our organisation. So we're sensitive to any changes in that more than anything else. Now, the planning assumption in the 5-year plan, and this is a plan that will change, we'll update it every year, but the current planning assumption is the workforce size will be retained. So in the short term, that means police officer numbers. Beyond that, it may be about the mix, as Mr. Page was saying. So what we have asked and what we've set out in the 5-year financial plan is that with regards to the commitment to real terms protection for the policing budget, that be based on unavoidable pay pressures. So it's pay awards, you know, any pay awards, things like the national insurance employer contributions that will be coming through, and anything of that nature that that we aren't able to meet through reducing the workforce would require that real terms protection, the increase in funding each year to reflect what, you know, the pay awards look like. With regards to non-pay, now that's the aspect where, you know, we know we're going to have quite considerable pressure coming through in ICT costs in particular, and this is happening across the public sector and the private sector, in that traditionally, IT costs were capital. You were buying things, you were having server rooms, but now it's moving more towards purchasing a service, which is a revenue cost. So we're expecting to see quite significant revenue costs coming through for ICT, both because of the switch from capital to revenue, but also the new capability that's looking to be developed over the coming years, such as rolling out body-worn video, if that's to go ahead, and creating a new unified communications platform. And other such things over the coming years. The way in which we plan to manage that is predominantly through our fleet strategy and estate strategy. So in the fleet strategy, we're looking to move from having a 100%, or what was a 100% diesel and petrol fleet, to move into electric. Now, there's two aspects around cost saving there. One is the cost of the powering the vehicles is a lot cheaper using electricity. So our fuel bill, which annually is somewhere in the region of £8 million, we would expect to see quite millions of pounds of savings there with electricity. But also, we operate a number of garages around the country, and we outsource work. Now, we're expecting there to be a lot less requirement for mechanics because of electric parts. So there's millions of pounds of savings there. And then in the estate, we are looking to move to a co-located model wherever possible. So we've got a first assumption when we look to look at a property in a particular area where we need to do something different is to move in with a partner. And a great example of that, which you may be aware of, is in the northeast in Aberdeen, where there are three big, or what were headquarter buildings, the old Grampian Police, Aberdeen City, Aberdeen Shire. Queen Street is being vacated, and we're moving into Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire accommodation. There's £1 million a year saving to the taxpayer just in that one property. Now, we're looking at 100 projects across the country, so we think there's a potential for very many millions of pounds worth of saving around estates rationalisation. Now, the one thing I would say about that, and it is a point that we've made when we've spoken to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, is that those savings don't necessarily come to policing. So whilst the cost of Queen Street might be £1 million a year that we're not paying, we're now paying the council's rent So we're not making £1 million, but the public sector is, and I think there needs to be, if there's going to be more collaboration and asset sharing, I think we need to look at the model at which we capture savings. But by and large, it's the fleet and the estate savings will compensate for the increased costs in our other areas of non-pay, and we're seeking real terms protection to mean that pay pressures are met, because if they're not, then we would have to look to reduce the workforce, and that's not our current planning assumption.
Thank you. That's really interesting. If I could just go back to the part about the cars, replacing them with electric cars, that's presumably coming from your capital budget. So is that going to mean a big uplift you're looking for in that?
So thank you for prompting me, because I should have said that in my answer. This five-year financial plan, and it's clear in the document, is dependent upon the capital investment required. And what we've said is, on the current level of capital investment, we estimate we would only get to about 40% electric fleet, because by the time we've managed to get to 40%, the first ones that we bought need to be replaced. So you're caught in a cycle. The alternative is effectively what we have been doing with the diesel and petrol cars, is they're just getting older and older. But, you know, we'd be trying to break out of that cycle of seeing, you know, I've walked down the mile here today and passed an 8-year-old police car, and we really shouldn't be having cars of particularly marked cars with blue light bars on them that might need to go out on response with vehicles of that age. They're safe because they're maintained, but the cost of maintaining them is quite significant because they're old.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Foley, I think you were wanting to come in.
Yes, please, thank you. I just declare an interest in that I'm married to a serving police officer. Thank you all for coming today. In respect of pay, you suggested earlier it makes up something like 80% of the overall budget. Now, the last pay award ran until April of this year, and I think talks are ongoing in respect of a new award. I think there's talks tomorrow, in fact. Can you tell me, if that was agreed any time soon, it would mean the award wouldn't likely happen until much before the end of the year, possibly into next year. What stage are the talks at? How confident are you of agreement? And given that these officers have faced the pandemic and now facing COP26, is this apparent delay not risk demoralising the rank and file?
Thank you for the question. Tomorrow is the police negotiating board, so we will be talking to the police then. We've been very clear from the outset, both with police officers and with the civilian staff, that A, we want to try and ensure that we treat both sides with parity. They're both really, really important to the policing family. Secondly, that any pay award that we put on the table has to be affordable. As Rona's just said, we've just had a very significant investment from Scottish Government to address our structural deficit. It's taken us a long time to get to that point. The last thing we want to do is, having just reached a balanced budget, is to then break our own budget by offering more than we can afford. So we've been very clear, both with the staff unions and with the Police Federation and ASPS, that any offer we make has to be affordable within our budget, and effectively our guidelines are going to be public sector pay policy. So that's our position going into any negotiations, and we've been very clear from the very outset, when we laid our budget last year, that would be the approach we would be taking.
A scale of 1 to 10, how confident are you it'll be agreed by the end of this year?
I can't really comment on how the Federation will react to the offer. They know what we can do, but I can't really comment on the Federation's position. I'm afraid you'd have to ask them.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, do you want to come in, Mr. Green? Yep.
Not come in off the back of this, but I do have wider questions about the budget.
Okay.
Do you want me to come in
whenever
it's free?
Yeah, just come in now.
Thank you. Good morning. I just wanted to take a step back and look at the wider budget, and I'm going to drill into your submissions, specifically in some of the numbers that are in, because this is pre-budget scrutiny. So you talk a lot in your submission, both submission one and two, about the five-year capital investment plan. And this number, £466 million, crops up quite a few times. But the same paper goes on to say that the Scottish Government's capital spending review seems to suggest that there will be a shortfall of £218 million over the next 5 years. That's quite a jump from what you're asking. Now, you partially set your case as to what would happen if the 466 is not met. In other words, you say that you will not be able to modernise our asset base to the minimum levels set out in our strategies. Could I elicit from you, if you don't get the 466 million capital budget five-year ask, what will you not be able to deliver?
Because the ask, if you look at it from a what we've asked for, which is what our assessment is of what the Police Service of Scotland needs to meet the tasks it's given versus what we think is going to be on the table. So to the first point I'd make is we're not gold-plating anything. We're not being hugely ambitious in our ask. What we're trying to do is just lay out very clearly what's required. In that requirement, there's two kind of major components. The first component is we have to spend an awful lot of money maintaining the service as it is. So our health and safety statutory regulatory requirements, that consumes an awful lot of our capital ask. Replacing police cars, the maintenance for buildings, specialist policing weapons and equipment and stuff like that. So we do need a core kind of base level of capital. And to be honest, what's been indicated in the what we think might be available is going to fund that. The additional monies is the monies that we're looking for to invest in policing to move it from where it is today to try and move it into that 21st century police force. So, and not just a 21st century police force, but a 21st century police force that's green, that reduces its cost base because of, as James has already said, we can move our officers into better accommodation, which is better for their welfare. We can provide them with vehicles that are green and more efficient. We can provide jobs that are actually jobs that people want to get into. They're not kind of old-looking, backward-looking jobs. They're actually jobs where the new economy is going to go, and we're operating in that space. More importantly, or as important, I should say, a lot of the capital links into transformational activity alongside our reform capital. So back to the point about how do we maintain a balanced budget. If we have capital and we have reform, that allows us to invest in transformational activities, which means that we can, body-worn video, other technical capabilities that creates capacity to meet new demand. So if we get the money, we can continue to push forwards, and we've been doing a good job of that so far, in trying to be a kind of leading public sector green organisation. We can reduce our cost base because we'll be more efficient. We can provide better working environment for officers and staff. And we can provide better tools and better innovation to both consume our own smoke in terms of absorbing demand, because we can use technology and innovation to do that, but also in keeping up with threat, harm and risk, because we know that on the kind of opposite side to us, there is investment going into technology. And as the convener's already said, cybercrime is growing at a kind of huge rate. So it gives us the ability to try and keep up with that. So it has a kind of double whammy effect.
So just kind of reading between the lines, it sounds like of the total ask that you've made and what you think is on offer, about half of it is business as usual, if you like. It's enabling you to perform to the current standards and levels of policing.
Yeah.
But the extra is the extra, if you like. It's what you think more will be needed to make those transformations that you want.
Yeah.
So you're not in any way suggesting that what is being proposed will not be enough to keep things at current levels, or maintain current policing levels, or maintain current workforce levels, or maintain the existing standards of service.
What we'll do if the profile is a profile that could come out, as you mentioned, is we'll sort of move more into kind of care and maintenance. So the principal call on the money will be around making sure we meet statutory requirements for health and safety.
Right.
The committee will be aware that some time ago we were in that place because of long-term underinvestment. And to be honest, I was having to cut budgets quite tight to operate within the budget we had. So I'd actually got to the point where I'd taken the budget down as far as I could, and then what was happening was I was having overspends each year, where we were having sort of failures on the health and safety front, and I was having to invest into that space. So we don't want to be in that space. We want to basically maintain what we have and then improve what we have, so it becomes both greener and more efficient and a better place to work.
And if we look at, for example, this financial year, 21-22, the total capital budget is 53.7 million. Now, my understanding is, I'm not sure if I read this in the papers or from last year's budget submission, but you asked for 85.7. So obviously you were given a lot less than was asked for, and we don't know what you'll be offered this year. But what effect did that £30 million shortfall have on your what it is you wanted to do with the business?
So the way we manage our capital now is we go out to the organisation and we ask what the capital need is. Now, we have a kind of rolling forward capital requirement because every year we know there's going to be so much money required to maintain buildings and things like that. So we sort of have some default numbers that go in to the capital budget. And then we look at our transformational needs and we look at for additional investment needs, the green fleet and things like that. So we work out what it is we need. And I have the finance team basically sense check all the numbers to make sure that we're asking for the right type of money, be it reform capital or revenue. But on the capital side, we'll work out what it is we need. Then what we do is run something called the capital investment group. We run it four times a year. On the capital investment group, effectively what we do is have all the senior police officers plus federation representatives and union representatives. And then what's important is that the allocation of capital isn't driven by my corporate side. It's actually driven by operational policing because they're the best placed individuals to work out where the money is. So there's then a discussion led by operational policing that says where we should put the money and effectively work out what the list is. And that's our kind of ask for 85 or £90 million. When we get the allocation, we then effectively have two columns. We have what we wanted and what we're given. And on the first thing we do on the what we're given is, on my side of the house, we look at the amount that's been given, and then we take out all the health and safety, all the statutory, all the legislative stuff, and then we allocate that straight away, because that's non-negotiable. The Chief Constable's made a commitment, as have I multiple times, that there'll be no compromise on spending on health and safety for our officers and for our staff. So we allocate all that money, and then what we've got is a residual amount, which is discretionary spend, and then what we do is look at all of the ask, and we say to the operational police officers, where do you want the money to go? And the interesting thing about that, of course, is a lot of our ask around, especially around the DDICT stuff, is there's a logical build. So sometimes you have to build infrastructure, you have to put the foundations in. The problem with that, of course, is it's not sexy, it's not interesting. People aren't that interested in the foundations. They all want the roof. When you've only got a little bit of money, people kind of are quite interested in saying, I want something nice and shiny. And it's a real challenge because police officers and our staff want something tangible, where what we're trying to do is build something that's long-lasting and sustainable. So we have a real kind of challenge around that. But it's driven by the operational police officers. And it's what could have an effect, what could help them deliver the job they do in the best way, although it might not be the most efficient way. So that's what we do.
And if you spend £50 million on body-worn cameras, it's something you can see and touch and feel and people will notice the difference. But you spend £50 million on software upgrade, which has a net benefit to the force, no one's very interested in that.
Well, no one's very interested in it, but the issue is the data is probably the key to the future.
Yeah.
And unless we can address properly the ICT infrastructure, our digital and data management, if you risk making mistakes at the end of the day. Body-worn video is a very useful tool, but again, it's a tool for capturing data. So the more kind of money that you put into making sure that you've got appropriate tools for the capture of data, for the management of data, the storage of data, the exploitation of data, and putting data into the justice system so that data's correct, you're going to get better justice outcomes. If you've got a shiny camera that takes nice pictures, it'll take nice pictures.
Interesting. Do I have time for one more question if it's to the SPA, specifically to Mr. Brown, and just to make you feel included in the conversation? In the very last paragraph of your of the submission, it says the authority will continue to make a strong case for, and you make a number of asks here, additional funding to the Scottish Government, including proposals for borrowing and upfront funding for long-term disposals and bridging finance. Can I just ask, how much additional funding are you asking of the government, or to give us an expectation ahead of the budget, the draft that comes out from the government? And what are these proposals for borrowing that you're looking for, and what will you do with all this extra money that you either are given or borrow?
Okay, thanks for the question, Mr. Green. The first thing I should probably say is that the authority considered both the five-year financial plan and the five-year capital plan last week and approved both of these, so it's fully supportive. On your specific question around upfront capital funding, what that really gets to is what Mr. Page was describing around the investment required in the estate primarily. So from memory, forgive me, I think there's about 160 million of investment in estates over the next 5 years required. Now, as you've already pointed out, there is on the face of it a dislocation between what the Scottish Government have published in their five-year financial plan and what our total capital ask is. So I suppose, you know, we need to consider what options there are for being able to accelerate that spend in whichever way that either the authority can or Police Scotland. In terms of the upfront capital receipts, what that is acknowledging is that, you know, the authority does have an estate with valuable assets in it that may not be that may be surplus to requirements, and by disposing those assets we would be able to make a significant contribution to that funding ask. There is a bit of a timing issue there, so very often before you exit a building you have to invest up front to have somewhere to go before you're able to release those receipts. So one of the options in the five-year capital strategy is if we were to receive some of our five-year capital funding up front, then that would enable the crystallisation of some of these receipts, which would then go back into the government coffers, if you like. On the issue specifically on capital, I don't think that's something that's pushed particularly hard. But again, if we are looking at all options, then that's something that probably needs to at least be part of the discussion, and the authority is supportive of that at least being on the table for consideration.
So just to be clear, to put it in pecking order, you would obviously rather just get the cash from the government to let you do what you want to do. But second to that, you can sell off the family silver, if you like. And worst case scenario, you can go and borrow it. Is that what you're saying to us?
Yeah, well, I think that obviously does simplify things. But I would say what this demonstrates is at least some creative thinking in the space, so that it's not just a case of if we don't get the money, then we can't do any of this. It's right. Just trying to come up with other feasible options for consideration.
Thank you, Kinder.
Okay, thank you very much. Ms. McNeill, are you wanting to come in?
Yes, very much. Convener, good morning. Just wanted to follow up, firstly, on the question the convener put to you on the issue of cybercrime. And you'll have seen the figures that it's doubled, really, in the last few years. So it's quite a significant issue for policing. But you did say to the convener that you're looking at the recruitment of civilian officers. Firstly, I mean, whose decision is that? I mean, I suppose the context is, I've heard this before, this idea that we'd recruit more civilians. There's a bit of a divided opinion about where is the line between not having police officers do the job and having others. So, first of all, is that the police authority's job? Or is it policing's job to make that decision about who would be civilian? And can you say anything about which jobs would be civilianised?
Certainly. It's Police Scotland's job to define that. It's an operational decision for the Chief Constable, ultimately. In terms of the kind of individual jobs in the cyberspace, that will be driven by the nature of the role. So DCC Malcolm Graham kind of is the deputy who looks after that area. He working with both his officers outside Police Scotland, because obviously there's an awful lot of expertise in the UK that we can draw upon, our own civilian staff, you know, our P&D function. We will define the jobs that we need. We will work out the job specification and the nature of the role. If the role requires a warranted power, then it will go to a police officer, obviously. If the role doesn't require a warranted power, or it requires kind of specific technical skills that doesn't kind of sit within the police job family, if you like, then we'd be looking at hiring civilian staff. The thing that's kind of quite important to kind of note on this one is, and the convener mentioned demand. Demand is increasing. You know, our demand stats are getting more and more kind of useful now in terms of the data that's being driven. And of course, as you've already said, that the cyber's going up. What we can't do is just keep building the police service. You know, we can't just keep add on extra bodies. So this is where the workforce mix comes into it. So if, for example, we needed, let's say 50 as an example, civilian staff, in order to maintain a balanced budget, I can't just go out and hire 50 civilian staff. We've got to work out how we get the capacity to hire 50 civilian staff. And that will become, the only way we can do that is through the myriad of ways that we've talked about, reducing our cost base through efficiencies, which creates money available to hire new staff, or changing our workforce mix. And that may mean that some of the roles that existed in Police Scotland historically are no longer as relevant as perhaps having new cyber roles. And we've got to balance that judgment quite carefully. We've got to engage with the unions on that side to ensure that people are aware of the direction of travel, give them an opportunity to engage in the discussion about that, and then move to hire those specialist staff whilst operating within the budget.
Thank you very much. I have a further question, which is a question that the Scottish Police Federation have posed, which is in relation to public confidence and just the pressures on police. And the specific example I wanted to ask you about was that, according to the Scottish Police Federation, approximately 50,000 arrestees which are due to be re-rostered as a consequence of operational demands outstripping available resources. And they're saying that beyond that, there's an additional 100,000 days have already been re-rostered to future dates. And the obvious question is, how long can we keep doing that for? And is the authority making any ask of the Scottish Government in order to programme that in? Because obviously through the pandemic, I presume police officers have had to put public policing first, and that builds up roster days. So it would be grossly unfair, I would have thought, not to recognise that that's an additional pressure on the policing budget. I wondered what your ask of the Scottish Government is in relation to that.
I think we do recognise that the RRDs trend currently is upwards, that the numbers quoted are the numbers. To provide some content, the banked RRDs equates to about 3 days per officer. Although the kind of 50,000 sounds like a scary number, if you like, when you look at it over a workforce the size that we've got, it is only about 3 days per officer. Having said that, we've got to manage this more effectively and more efficiently. So, to be honest, I don't think we would be making an ask of the Scottish Government. I think it's incumbent on Police Scotland to manage that better. And I think it's something that we need to do, and we have acknowledged that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Before we move on, I've just maybe if I can come back and ask a very quick question, just staying on the subject of estates. I'm aware that there was an estate condition survey being undertaken, and I think that perhaps that was due to be published or reported back on some time ago. I just wondered if you had maybe an update on that.
Yes, thank you, Convener. That's right. Before the pandemic, we had committed to report back to committee, and COVID slowed down the pace at which we did the condition survey work. We've got over 300 buildings that were assessed, and many thousands of component parts. So that work is now completed. The initial findings have been put into a report that has been presented internally within Police Scotland, and we'll soon be in a position, once that's been through the authority, to be able to report back here. But to give you a flavour of what's in it is that there were some immediate works required that were identified as kind of health and safety activities, a couple of £1 million. Those things are either complete or are underway at the moment, so that's the stuff that was the kind of the things that had to be done immediately. But what it told us is there's about £242 million worth of works that need to be done over the next 10 years to get our estate up to condition B. So, we're not looking to gold plate it. We're just looking to have buildings that are of a reasonable condition, as condition B is the term used. Our estate current condition, and it goes back to the earlier question about maintaining our asset base. So that when we're talking about maintaining, we're talking about maintaining it from the level that it's at. So our estate is somewhere similar to what the school estate in Scotland looked like prior to the Schools of the Future programme. So in pretty poor condition. So we've got the bulk of the buildings are at the very bottom end of condition B and into condition C, and we're looking to get them up to all into condition B. So that work is currently being done to look about how we get into a planned maintenance cycle. And, you know, based on the 10 years of 242 million, obviously we'd like to do as much of that in the early years as we can. But even if it was spread evenly over 10 years, that's still £24 million a year. And it goes to the point about, well, what are we currently spending on the estate on maintenance? About 12. And that's an awful lot more than we were doing in previous years, because our capital allocation has gone up. But still, it's some way short of what we need in order just to get the buildings up, as I say, to a condition B status. We're not looking to have everything shiny and new. We're just looking for it to, you know, not have mould on the carpets or parts of the buildings that aren't air and, you know, wind and water tight. Because we do have buildings that aren't wind and water tight, where parts of the buildings have had to be shut down. So we're just looking to do that. And that condition survey's pointed that out and identified, as I say, 242 million over 10 years to get to a reasonable condition.
Okay, thank you. And just as a kind of follow-up question on that, one of the issues that we've been looking at is custody provision. And I know, as a former officer, there is good custody provision and not so good across the estate in Scotland. I'm interested in whether or not the specifically custody provision was looked at within the survey, and if you could comment on any particular plans from a budget perspective around improving some of the custody provision that needs to be improved.
So custody was covered, but that was based on the current model, and there has been investment over the past two or three years into custody, and, you know, in particular, most recently in London Road in Glasgow. But what we're looking to develop, and you know, I could get more information from a colleague, ACC McDonald, who's a lead for this area, is to have a custody remodelling plan. So to actually look at the custody across the entire country about, you know, right locations, right quality, because we know that there are things that we can do to improve. We have improved, but there's still some way to go. But that custody remodelling work is underway, and the estates team are working closely with that team in order to identify what the future need will be. But we haven't actually published, or haven't got to the point of deciding what that is and publishing it. But I can commit to bring back more information if that would be helpful.
That would be helpful. Thank you very much. If there's no more questions specifically on budget and this capital budget side of things, I'll move on to looking at COVID and COP26. And I think there were some questions, perhaps, Russell, if you...
Yes, please. Yeah. Thank you. In respect of COP26, there have been reported figures as to how much the policing will cost. I think the most recent that I've seen was £250 million and that was reported at some point last year, which, putting it in perspective, equates to, I think, a fifth of the entire Scottish policing annual budget. Can you tell us, either Police Scotland or indeed the SPA, what the likely projection is now at, the latest projection?
So we are constantly updating our projections, and especially in the lead up, as things crystallise when we get specifics around numbers of world leaders, locations, but this is, you know, changing day to day, as you'll be aware. We've consciously not put a figure out in regard to the cost, because it can be confusing. Because I could have given you a different figure every month for the past, the past 18 or 19 months that we've been working on it. But safe to say that the amount of funding that we as policing in Scotland have secured from the UK Government Spend Approval Board is over £60 million. Now, that's the direct costs that we are currently aware of. That doesn't mean that's what it will be. After the event, we will make, you know, we'll do look at the actuals, and it's the actuals that we'll be looking to get funding on. But based on our known direct costs, it's over £60 million that's been secured. But that doesn't include the cost of accommodation, which is significant, which has been picked up through the Home Office, I believe, and the cost of mutual aid, so the cost of police officers from other UK forces coming up to Scotland, and that is a considerable cost as well, and that's been dealt with by the Home Office. So our direct element of it is over 60, but when you take the three components together, it's not as much as 250 million, is my understanding, but it's upwards of 150.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think perhaps, Mr. McGregor, you were wanting to come in on this.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And it's as following up on the COP26 stuff. We were out at the crime campus in Gartcloche a couple of weeks ago there, and we got, obviously, a rundown and some of the plans for it, and it's quite incredible, and the scale of it, and, fair play to the police for taking this on. And I don't think you'll ever have to do something as big as this in a long time again. But one of the things that Chief Constable said there, he said he was really keen that there was no additional cost to Police Scotland. So you've talked there about the 60 million, but clearly there's going to be an element of costs that we can't currently predict. We don't know how it's going to go. We don't know where protests are going to be, etc., etc. So are you feeling quite reassured that there will be no cost to Police Scotland in the end? Have you got that assurance from the UK government?
So we do have that assurance from the UK government. At the very start of this process, that the kind of finance business principles were agreed with the Cabinet Office around this, and the number one on the list was no financial detriment to the policing budget in Scotland. As I say, I didn't want to get into specifics around what we think the cost projection is going to be now, because as you rightly point out, it's a projection. We won't know until after the event what was required around additional overtime and so forth, and also not just in relation to the policing of COP26, but because there's such significant numbers of police officers in Scotland being focused on COP26, that there are the remaining officers that will have to deal with the usual day-to-day policing, and that may require higher levels of overtime because of officers that are on other duties. And depending on what happens, as you say, around protest, that will have an impact on the number of officers that will be required for COP26 on a day-to-day basis versus those that might be able to come back out and do normal business as usual activity. So there's so many moving parts that we won't know until after the event. And we've been clear with the Cabinet Office around this, and that, you know, we will have a kind of wash-up session where we look at what the actual cost was against what we had a best assessment of a forecast, and we will look to be compensated for the full cost. And beyond that, if something were to happen that would result in potential litigation against the Chief Constable or the police authority, we have also sought assurance that those costs that may take years to crystallise will also be covered, and we have that assurance that the cost will not fall on the policing budget.
I think I'd be all right to get another supplementary. And when will you have that discussion? And the reason why I'm asking is because I can't envisage a situation where there won't be some sort of long-term cost to the police in Scotland. And so is there an assurance there from the UK government that the cost can be looked at longer term? The things I'm thinking about, which I'm sure you've all been through loads, is you know, like, well, we've got this massive event, people will be working overtime, people will need time off after that. That might reduce services a wee bit, or I'm sure it won't reduce core services, but people might be off, with stress or whatever as well. We just don't know. So the discussion that you're talking about having, I feel quite assured that from what you're saying, the UK government are going to sort of fund that. But what about the sort of knock-on effect just over the next year, the next couple of years? Because I can't see that, you know, we're not going to be affected by that ultimately, because it's a massive event.
The first part, which is the kind of most acute, is the thing about the re-rostered rest days and so on, and we have built that into our forecast costs up front. Now, as you say, we don't know exactly what those will be, but certainly we've got some financial provision being made by UK government for what we think they might be. But as I say, that there's that kind of true up, if you like, afterwards, and probably, you know, we would be targeting, you know, it's the degrees of accuracy to be kind of, you know, 95% of the way there early in the new year, to probably by next June being kind of 99%, but you're right, there's likely to be some residual, and it, you know, we'll do the best we can to capture it, but you know, there's no, can't guarantee that absolutely 100% of things like psychological illness as a result of the event that maybe doesn't happen for a period of time afterwards, that, you know, to make sure that we're capturing all of that and being able to attribute it specifically. But we've got arrangements in place and an agreement, and the position of finance business principles around no detriment. So we will work on the basis that there'll be that good faith there with the UK government to work through these things with us, so that, you know, even if it goes into the next financial year, we will still be looking to pick that up. And when the COP26 finance unit disbands, that we have a contact that we can go to if we need to continue the conversation beyond the end of this financial year.
Thank you very much. Mr. Page, would you like to come in, and then I'll bring in Mr. Brown?
Thank you. Just to build on what James is saying, one of the things that we're acutely aware of, and part of the conversation with the Cabinet Office, has been that we, from the very start, have been very, very clear on both our finance principles and evidencing what we say. So one of the things we're doing from a finance perspective is working very, very hard to make sure we capture early what's going on, what's those effects from COP26, and we can evidence it, so that when we do go back to the Cabinet Office, we do so with an evidence base. So we're doing our best to ensure that our argument for recovery is supported by the best evidence we can do. And James and his team have been working very, very closely with ACC Higgins to make sure that we, you know, finance isn't an after effect of this. Finance is actually integrated into the early planning, and we've been working very, very closely to ensure that our systems allow us to capture the difference between, as you say, what was a business as usual activity. You know, there might be some protests somewhere, which might be BAU, nothing to do with COP26, or there might be COP26 protests all over the country. You know, we don't know, but we're trying very hard to make sure we capture things early on, so that there's an audit trail that allows us to make our case strongly.
Okay. We follow up supplementary. Something that kind of came to me, that I, as I say, I do feel quite assured, actually, that, you know, the UK government are going to fund what they say they will. But I'm still wondering about this long-term effect. And do you think there's some scope? I mean, it might be too early to say this, but do you think there's some scope for an additional funding maybe coming UK government, either straight to the police or via the Scottish Government, if there's a role for the Parliament hearing that, or of some sort of additional payment to cover things over the next few years? Because I get the stuff that you can sort of you can say this happened, that happened, and there's a trail of it, but there will be just a knock-on effect, basically. You know, I wonder if that's something that you're already thinking about, or not quite at that stage.
I don't think we've everything that the Cabinet Office have sort of asked of us is that it's evidence-based to date. I think what you're saying is true. I think there's a really good chance there might be something like some sort of lag. How we quantify that, and at what point is the line drawn? We, as part of the kind of the COP26 finance planning side, Scottish Government are involved in that. SG officials are in the middle of that. So that type of risk is something that they'll be acutely aware of as well. What we will do as we go through the kind of COP26 event and the immediate after effect, if we start to see emergence of those things, then we will be engaging very early with the COP26 spending team and the Cabinet Office to kind of put early markers down, and we'll be working alongside the SG officials, because as much as it's incumbent upon us to do the kind of work on the ground and do the finance work on the ground and build the evidence base, there is quite a political element into this as well, and that's where SG officials working with ministers is just as important for us in terms of making sure we get a fair and appropriate recovery.
Mr. Brown, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just very briefly to provide some additional assurance. So from the authority standpoint, you know, we are comfortable that every reasonable step has been taken to protect the business as usual policing budget from the impact of COP26. And hopefully that will come across as well. What will also come across is how detailed the planning has been for this. It's planning at a level that I don't think we've seen, certainly from the authority standpoint. So there should be additional reassurance from that. In terms of your final point, which you picked up with Mr. Page, if there is any lasting legacy, you know, we, I think, can be confident that if there's anything that we need to pick up and make a specific case for with whoever we need to make a case with, we will certainly do that. Because, like I say, you know, the objective post-event will certainly be making sure that the policing budget does not have any adverse impact from COP26.
Thank you very much. Colette Stevenson, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. It's really just on COP26, and I suppose for me it would be the accounting principles in terms of the money coming forward and how that would look within your, you know, accounts and even within, from a procurement perspective, obviously there's going to be a higher spend, and just how that's going to look. Is it going to be, you know, is it going to be separated? You know, you talk about COP26, spending committee and whatnot. It's just to see how that's realised, basically, and going forward, because I know that Audit Scotland will probably be keen. And if there is any legacy payments coming forward, I'd be interested to know how that's going to look. Thanks.
Thank you for the question, and it's actually a very topical one. We had our annual reports and accounts signed off last week at the board there, and I've already started the conversations with our statutory reporting team about the presentation of next year's annual report and accounts. And what we plan to do is actually engage with Audit Scotland early on to make sure we have a common understanding of what's required. I think from a statutory reporting perspective, we will obviously show the costs that are directly attributable, you know, the costs that we incurred directly. So that won't include, as I say, accommodation and mutual aid, because they'll be picked up through UK government accounts. But the costs that we have directly will be included within our numbers. Now, it's not coming through as resource dealt, so there's a question around part of the accounts about do we treat it as income that we reimburse them rather than funding. So I've got the team working on that, and that, you know, they're going through the FREM, and we'll be taking guidance from SIP for Technical and Audit Scotland. But I think we would, as a note in the annual report and accounts, would have to set out, instead of it just being in the entire numbers, we would probably separate it out to be clear about what was the business as usual cost and what was the COP26 cost. But there isn't a statutory reporting requirement in the FREM, as far as I understand it, to separate it out for the statutory accounts. But for good practice and disclosure, we would probably have a note to show what was business as usual policing and what was COP26 policing.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Just quickly, if I may, before we move on from COP26, because I know some other members are wanting to come in and look at individual areas of police budget. Just looking at overtime arising from COP26, and I know there will be a lot, it was really just to ask if the provision will include covering overtime costs, or will that have to be managed separately?
So there's two elements around that. The first is the directly attributable overtime for the officers that have been deployed to COP26. That cost that we've forecast has been funded by UK government to date. Now, again, once we see what the actual number is, there'll be that kind of truing up. But there'll also likely be costs of officers that are picking up work as a consequence of other officers being on COP26. So that's an indirect overtime cost. We have an element of that funded by UK government, but the reality is until we get through November, depending on what the demands are on business as usual policing, we won't know to what extent that overtime is required. So we're absolutely aware of it. We've got funding for what we know of, and I can give an assurance that after the event, we have got robust plans for recording the overtime, as Mr. Page was saying, that we will take that to UK government to seek the full funding.
Thank you very much. I think if members are happy, we'll move on from COP26. As I say, I know there are a number of members who'd like to look at specific individual areas of policing or policy. So I'll maybe hand back to Rona Mackay, and then I'll bring in Colette Stevenson after that.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener. Yes, I'd just like to ask about the planning ahead, spending on the new budget that you get. In particular, the areas I'm interested in are rape and sexual crimes and domestic abuse, and also on a wider level, the sort of culture of police in terms of corporate policies on bullying and racism, homophobia, misogyny, that kind of thing. Are you earmarking funds for those, and if so, you know, can you expand on it?
In terms of, I think there's two parts of the question, I think, there. In terms of funds that we allocate for crimes against women in terms of domestic violence and rape, that becomes part of our budget allocation through the different divisions. So under DCC Graham, ACC Judy Heaton, the kind of the public protection domestic violence, they set a provision, or they ask, make a request effectively. And that's what we kind of put in the budget for them. So whatever's asked for in that space, we'll make sure there's a provision for it. So I think that kind of covers that part of it.
Particularly the great rise in domestic abuse cases, and you know, I just wondered if that was something that would feature.
It would feature in so much as ACC and DCC Graham would look at the demand trends there.
Yeah.
If they need to allocate more resource into that area, then that would feed through in terms of our budget planning.
Mm-hmm.
Effectively, it's a good question, because if you look at the quantity of police officers we have, and that's on the rise, then it's a bit like kind of pushing the balloon. You know, you have to move more resource over there. The money follows the officers in that space, and then we would have to look at the demand pressures elsewhere. So it's a balancing act. But obviously, ultimately, the chief constable sort of acts as the arbiter in terms of that. But any requirements for additional funding there would be made by the ACC and the DCC in that area, which would then come through to us. In terms of internally within Police Scotland, in terms of our culture, the Chief Constable has made it very clear, the senior force executive have made it very clear, we've made it clear in statements to the board that those types of behaviours are not accepted. Issues that arise that reflect that type of behaviour happening are completely rejected, and we are doing our utmost to try and ensure that we improve in those areas and don't accept those areas. And obviously there's been a huge amount of reaction to recent events, quite rightly. You know, we're all horrified by them. And what we're doing at senior command level is looking inward at ourselves to both make sure that how do we provide a service that can be trusted by the public in light of recent events, and there's been steps taken already by the service on that front, but also looking inwardly, how can we look at our own behaviours, our own culture, and address that? So it is it's not a kind of a topic that's not at the top of our agenda. It's right at the top of our agenda, both in terms of public confidence, in terms of ensuring that we operate a workforce, both officers and staff, that is a workforce that, you know, men, women, people can be safe to be in. That is right at the top of the Chief Constable's kind of list.
Does that include extra training for officers in any of the areas?
Where it's required, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anil. I'll bring in, if I can bring in Russell Finlay, and then I'll come on to yourself, Colette.
Thank you very much. I'd like to ask about the use of non-disclosure agreements by Police Scotland. Now these, for people who aren't aware, are used in the payment of compensation deals with people in order to keep the details of those payouts secret or confidential. Now it's been reported that the value of such claims have breached £1 million since 2013, and I think they raise serious questions about transparency and accountability around public money. Even just today, we heard of a successful tribunal claim brought by a female police officer called Rona Malone. Her career was destroyed by what was described as sort of boys' club culture. And previously, she was offered to settle on condition that she signed a non-disclosure agreement. Mr. Gray, do you think these are compatible with good governance and public confidence and accountability?
So non-disclosure agreements are not something that I would expect us to do? And the figure that you've said, I think the majority of them were probably in the early years. I don't think, I mean, I'm certainly not aware of any in recent times. I've not seen or been involved in any discussion of that nature. We're not supposed to do them, I know that. You know, there may be certain circumstances, and certainly not in this particular case, but the, because of particular sensitivities where, you know, they may on occasion be used, but certainly no, I agree with your sentiment.
Thank you. In regards to non-disclosure agreements, our guidance is the ACAS guidance, effectively, which says NDAs can be used legitimately in some cases, usually around confidentiality and protecting of commercial sensitivity. So we would use them in those grounds. What ACAS guidance is and what our position is that they absolutely should not be used where it's to prevent sexual harassment, discrimination, whistleblowing, or anything like that. That would be a completely inappropriate use of an NDA, and it's not something that we would...
Completely incompatible with the offer that was put to Rona Malone. Her case was one of sexual discrimination, and they attempted to use these in order to settle, and settle confidentially, and the public would have been unaware of what transpired.
So I can't comment on that case, because obviously it's only broken this morning, but what I'm saying is,
and
our
there's
guidance...
Also, sorry to interrupt again, there's a contradiction between what you're saying and what Mr. Gray's saying. Mr. Gray's saying these are not compatible. They have no place, is my understanding.
Sorry, I said there were certain rare exceptions, but certainly in this particular case, you know, right. as Mr. Page says, it's in those very limited circumstances.
Just coming back to the question... Sure. Just to make the point about, I think you said these were mostly historic, but according to a media report just this week, there have been seven in the past couple of years, all females, three officers, three civilian, and one member of the public.
I can't comment on those numbers, I'm unaware. I'm happy to write to the committee and provide some more data on that once I get the facts on that. But
I think if I may ask members to confine questioning to budgetary issues, I know where you're going with this.
Can I ask one question of the SPA?
But I would ask
same,
if you would respectfully confine your questioning to budget provision
considerations. This is budgetary. It's for Mr. Brown. It's in respect of NDAs. It's just whether you've had any discussion with the police or expectations around the use of these and how these can impact on budgets.
Not to my knowledge, but I will follow up on that.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. McNeill, do you want to come in on this particular?
Nothing else.
Okay, thank you very much. Colette Stevenson.
Thanks, Convener. And I just wanted to touch upon your procurement practices. There were several recommendations brought forward from your last, albeit I know you've just had your recent accounts signed off. I had an opportunity to actually look at them. But going by the previous ones, there was a recommendation about putting forward a procurement improvement plan in place and your future spend as well. And I just wanted to look at things like openness and transparency. And you have talked about innovative and creative thinking going forward and in terms of suppliers and whatnot as well. So it's just to see what steps and what actions going forward you've got in place in terms of your spend and any savings that could be made there. The other thing I just wanted to ask about in terms of spend was focusing on misuse of drugs as well. So for instance, what in terms of naloxone, you know, officers carrying naloxone, is there a new budget going forward for the likes of things like that in order to tackle misuse of drugs?
Okay, I can take this one. So thank you for the question. Start by addressing the point around the improvement activity. So there has been a procurement improvement plan. That's largely been worked through, and there's been significant improvement in our procurement practices in the organisation, which has been recognised by both internal and external audit. There's still more work to be done. We've still got areas where we can improve and tighten up. But by and large, I think the spending is now well controlled, and we've finally managed to roll out a P2P system across the organisation to get standardised purchasing practices across the organisation? Because as you'll be aware, the focus in the early years of Police Scotland was making sure that the operation of policing, operational policing, continued to be effective. Some of the corporate improvement work that required has taken a bit longer, so in effect we had 8 different procurement teams still operating, but that's now been brought into a single team. So good foundation. We also had a procurement strategy that was approved by the SPA board last week, and that looks to build on the previous one, which is mostly focused on compliance, which is important, and that's obviously a continuing focus, but we are looking to broaden that out around looking at the environmental practices of suppliers and considering whether that should there should be weighting a portion to that in any kind of ITT, you know, tendering exercises. We're looking at the employment rights of people that work in organisations. So we've been doing this and we've been improving over time, but we're really putting more focus on it and actually, like, are our suppliers good employers, and can we use our buying power as leverage to try and change behaviours if they need changing. And we're also looking at the profile of our spend and where we spend money, and trying to push more money into local communities where we can, especially around supporting recovery of COVID, to make sure that, you know, we are a national organisation, so there are times where we have to do things at a national level. But even something like facilities management, where we have a national provider for hard facilities management, that making sure where we can that there's subcontracting being done to local firms around the country. So we're trying to really put a focus on that and use our buying power to try and help support better outcomes that are linked to the national performance framework. On your final point around the misuse of drugs, I would need to write back to committee on that around the detail of it. It's a relatively low level of spend, so I haven't personally been involved in that, but I can find the detail around the procurement activity in relation to that and the cost.
What we can say is whatever's asked for on the Loxone front, we'll make provision for it. It's a relatively small number in terms of our budget, but there's no specific case come to us to ask for it, which means it's being absorbed within the normal budgetary envelope that's available in that area of the business.
Can I just come back on that? I think there's a cost involved in terms of the training as well that will be included in that as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, thanks.
Are you wanting to ask a follow-up question on that, Mr. McGregor, or bring in Pauline McNeill first?
Well, it does follow up on that, yeah. But I'm quite happy for Pauline to come in first. I think she had her hand up before.
Yeah, I'll bring in Pauline McNeill on that.
It's on a different subject, is that okay?
Yes, that's fine.
Thank you. I just wanted to go back, as a question probably to do with the capital budget, but you can tell me, perhaps for you, Mr. Brown, but again, you can tell me. It's, again, the Scottish Police Federation evidence in relation to co-location of police services. So their concern is that, well, I'm sure it's a shared concern about the poor condition of the police estate, so looking for opportunities to co-locate. What the SPF have said, well, in those cases, it would mean that Police Scotland would be the tenant and not the landlord, and that there would be increased revenue in the long run if there was more co-location of services. And they say that it tends to suggest that it's desperation rather than suitability is the key driver. So I suppose my question is this a principle of the authority or Police Scotland to seek co-location, or is it a measure of last resort? And I suppose my concern would be, obviously there are immediate pressures, but looking to the future, I wouldn't have thought it would be ideal in most cases to co-locate. It has been controversial, I have to say, in the past, to co-locate when they're completely different services from other services they might be sharing a building with. Thank you.
If I may, thank you for that question. It's not for the SBA authority to determine where police officers are located. That's the Chief Constable's decision in the first instance. We obviously, in terms of estate strategy, planning, disposals, need authority approval, but the drive for it comes from operational requirements. In terms of our estate strategy, the estate strategy obviously has a component of kind of prudent financial management. What's the best way we can make use of the assets? As James has already said, both the condition survey we've recently carried out and the condition survey that was carried out in 2015 highlighted a very large amount of funds required to bring the police estate up to where it needed to be. And the committee will all be aware of the multiple photographs that have been in the press over many years from the Federation of very poor accommodation, which we've been, obviously, with the investment challenges we've had, we've been struggling to do. The estate strategy around co-location, again, is driven operationally. So although the estate strategy itself is a kind of corporate strategy, because it kind of falls under my purview, the direction of what does the police service want now and in the future from its estate is driven by the operational policing requirements. One of those key requirements was almost to kind of recognise that the police estate as was, with basically a police station located in every village alongside the pub, the doctors and whatever, that's not necessarily what's required now. What was required was better integration of the police service with other public sector services, and recognising that policing is part of a process that deals with the challenges that people have, and better integration with other public bodies does a couple of things. A, it can help improve the service delivery. Secondly, both for us and for other public bodies, shared location, shared costs. So it reduces the overall burden on the public sector. We also make sure that we still have visibility where we need to in those co-located areas. It will still be very visibly where we need it to be, a policing presence. So that's very much an operationally driven requirement, principally by DCC Kerr, because that's the local policing footprint. It's not driven purely by the finance. The other issue we've got is our net carbon ambition to kind of obviously green our estate in line with Scottish Government's requirements, UK Government requirements. A lot of our estate is very old. Not only do we have a very large maintenance bill associated with it, but to kind of green it would be very, very expensive. So again, we're looking at the location of the estate in the context of ability to provide policing services to community, our ability to make that estate fit and habitable for police officers and staff, and getting best value for money. And that's where the co-location approach has come forward. As James already said, the feedback we've had from the officers and staff in the northeast about the move in Aberdeen has been incredibly positive. They're now operating and working in much, much, much better conditions. It's greener and it costs me less money to run.
Thank you. I maybe need to pursue this a wee bit further at another time, because there's quite a lot of different priorities there about decarbonising the estate. Yeah. And I've experienced it myself in my own patch in Glasgow about the poor estate. And I'm glad you said visibility, because from the public's point of view, what they'll be interested in, police office is quite different from any other environment, and I would argue needs to be so. Visibility is really important. And whilst I would not want to think it would be completely driven by best value, because it's a service, it's quite service. Distinct. You would agree with that?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr Green, do you want to come in now?
Thank you. I just wanted to touch on an area which is linked to the budget, but it's about the financial sustainability as part of your medium and long-term plans. And I just wanted to refer specifically to your submission to the committee on that. There's quite a lot of wording in there. I know the last question session I asked more about the numbers, but this is more about the strategy. And it just raises maybe some cause for concern that I wanted you to help alleviate for me. You talk about your financial plan, which is your current five-year financial plan, how you maintain sustainability. And you indicate that the current plan will maintain current levels of policing, but it is dependent on a number of key factors. And you list those four key factors. Now, that strikes me as quite key, because the key factors include an increase in line with commitment to real terms protection. I want to ask specifically what you mean by real terms protection. Managing the workforce size. And I want to ask you what you mean by managing the workforce size, because surely an increase means higher expenditure. Managing non-pay pressures and receiving compensatory funding to support income loss due to COVID. Now, those are quite big issues. So my first question is, on it, you know, what is the risk factor in these four key determining factors that allow you to maintain current levels of policing? And the second question is, what has the government indicated to you in response to these asks?
I'll start off, if you don't mind, and then James maybe come in with some more specific numbers. In terms of real terms protection, as we've already said, about 86% of our entire budget is people. It's a huge number within our overall budget. The biggest pressure there is pay. We've committed to operating within our budget. If pressures come into us to take us outside of that, they have to be funded from elsewhere, otherwise we can't operate within our budget. And that includes things like national insurance hikes. The current national insurance increase, which will come in from April next year, is going to put 11.5 million, roughly, into our budget. So again, 11.5 million pounds is an awful lot of money. And if that national insurance isn't covered by the Scottish Government, they'll have to make cuts somewhere. So that's the kind of the importance of real terms. It has to cover all of those kind of inflationary people-related costs that come in from the outside over and above our core budget. The workforce management point is a very, very important one and a very tricky one to manage, because as you've said, you can't just keep growing headcount because your bills go up effectively. As again, we've already mentioned, we do need to increase our headcount in certain areas, example cyber, because of there's increasing demand there, and we know we need to recruit people with specialist skills into those areas. Now, there's only two ways I can fund that. Either we make non-pay savings, you know, we because of the economies of scale that James has already mentioned, we reduce our bills, and then I use some of that surplus to fund those extra jobs. But we've already been pressing down on that budget for a very long time, so you know there's not that much margin there. We could, using reform funding and capital, use transformation to create capacity, so body-worn video and other technical means that creates a gap where it means it costs less for us to deliver a current service, and the gap I can then use to push it into cyber. Or alternatively, and the one that's probably the trickiest of all, as long as I get the money on the capital and reform, is the workforce mix. Now, if we've got a defined number of workforce at the moment, and I need, say, 50, for example, cyber specialists, and there's a cost associated with that, and all other things being equal, I don't have the money from elsewhere, we'll have to change the workforce mix. And this is where I mentioned this at the SPA Resources Board a couple of weeks back. At that point, we need to think about the jobs we do in policing, because what we can't do is recognise that demand requires new jobs, but just keep adding the new jobs to the mix, because policing will just continue to get more expensive. At that point, we've got to think about the positioning of policing in terms of the services we currently deliver. And at that point, when we've done everything we can, we know that there's no more money coming from Scottish Government to help fund that on top of everything else we have, we'll have to look at, do we provide the services that we currently provide? Because if we don't, we need to deprioritise some of those services and redirect the funding for those services across into new jobs. At that point, we'll be offering voluntary redundancy or voluntary early retirement to staff in those areas which are less of a priority currently than they used to be, because that's how we'll balance the budget.
But just can I just listening to your answer and to previous answers, why are we resourcing the police to budget and not budgeting to the resource needs? Because it sounds to me like every answer you've given me with respect is around how you meet a balanced budget, not how much does it cost to actually adequately police. And that sounds like a very different approach to perhaps what we're used to.
So two answers to that. First one on the capital side. About 3 years ago, we changed the way that we articulated our capital requirements, because at that point, we publicly, both at board and at committee level, and in our published reports, were very explicit in what policing needed from a capital position. And at that point, everyone was able to see what we needed to deliver policing versus what we were given. And that's where you get that gap between, you know, we've asked for 80, 90 million and we get 50 million. So we've been quite explicit on that. Up until this budget that's been granted, we've been operating a structural deficit anyway. So we were having to build transformation activity with a view to reducing police officer numbers. The additional, because that was the most expensive part of our budget, the structural deficit additional funding we got this year put us into a balanced budget position. Having said that, like all public bodies, we have to operate within our balanced budget. We will try to operate within our balanced budget by doing the things I've just mentioned, because that's good management practice, effectively operate within your budget. There may well be a point where there's a demand on policing that we require to meet that we can't do it internally without compromising current service delivery. At that point, we do need to go to the Scottish Government and make a case to say we need additional funding to meet this type of demand. At the point we do that, it has to be backed up with really solid evidence and data that shows that we're not shroud waving. What we're doing is being very explicit about the fact we're managing the police service as efficiently as we can, but notwithstanding that, there's an additional demand on us that we do need some support on. And at that point, once we've taken it through our own police governance, we'll go via the board to be scrutinised and challenged there, but then it will come onto the table for the Scottish Government.
What are these savings that are required to maintain financial balance that you talk about in your submission?
Yeah, I can pick that part up. So the savings are predominantly around the fleet and the estate, the things that you know that we were touching upon earlier on. So an electric fleet, again, dependent upon funding, will be a lot cheaper to operate than the current diesel petrol fleet. And the estate, if we are able to make more use of co-location opportunities, that will reduce the cost. So having done that initial estimate around what we think we might be able to deliver, subject to funding, then that would broadly meet the pressures, the non-pay pressures that we anticipate over the next 5 years.
Mm. Okay.
To quickly come in, I have a final follow-up question if you can be quite brief.
When you just drilling down further, when you talk about the savings in terms of your fleet, so, and I'm going to bring in a financial technical thing here in terms of, so I take it then, you will no longer, from a capital spend, it'll be a revenue spend. I think you touched upon it earlier, so you'll be leasing electric fleet. So it would be across over 5 years then, rather than a one-off capital spend. Is that correct? Yeah.
So the two parts. I think our saving will come. Our saving is a pure revenue saving in the sense of the fuel costs versus the electricity costs. That's revenue saving, and the reduction in the size of the workforce to maintain the fleet. That'll be a revenue saving. The piece on the leasing model, you're right, that has in the past been, you know, a revenue cost, whereas buying a car is capital. But with the introduction of IFRS 16, I don't want to get into the detail of that is likely that it will be mostly capitalised, and we have flagged this with our colleagues in Scottish Government to make them aware of what we're planning to do and what that impact would be, and we're still waiting to hear back. And I think in turn the finance is waiting to hear from Treasury around how it's going to be managed, so that we understand the full implications of it. But my understanding is that there'll be adjustments to RDEL and CDEL to reflect the new accounting implications of it. So I don't know the answer yet until we have clarity over what the accounting treatment will be.
So you're waiting on clarification from the Treasury on that?
We'll get it from Finance and Scottish Government, but I think they're waiting from Treasury, was the last update I had.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I'm just looking at our time. We've slightly overrun, but I'd like to bring the session to a close with a question around your digital strategy, which we've not really covered today. Obviously, your five-year capital investment plan includes sort of continued rollout and work around your digital strategy. And obviously there's been some criticism, for example, around the call handling side of the Police Scotland function. So I'm just really interested to maybe ask a bit about what the priorities will be and the budgetary implications for making sure that strategy continues as planned.
Thank you, Kavina. We are actually in the process of, as part of the digital data and ICT, which we published a good number of years ago now, there is a technical project called the Unified Communications UCCP project, which we're going to be pushing off into early next year. That's the project that effectively all blue light services and public sector services are going to have to address at some point because of the analog system BT's turning off in 2025. So this is the kind of replacement for the old analog BT lines. We're going to have digital lines. It also gives us multi-channel capability. That's a part of the DDICT strategy, which has been on the stocks for a long time, which will introduce new technical capability and better service capability, if you like, into our call centres. It's also a project and a programme which will be mirrored elsewhere across the public sector. As all the work we do currently, are working very closely with our blue light colleagues in fire and ambulance to look at procurement opportunities to share, estates opportunities to share, both to kind of reduce our cost base and improve efficiency. UCCP would be one of those things where we are being quite open and transparent with those areas to say, this is what we've got to do, we'll share it, we'll work with you as much as we possibly can to help all of us be more efficient, to be honest.
Thank you very much. Mr. Gray, you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Just picking up on the funding question, and I think it's quite nicely links back to the discussion on the capital ask. It's in that £466 million over the 5 years, and it has been in our ask in the 85 when we got the 50. So if you were to go back to when the strategy was published, I think it was 2018, then actually had the funding been what had been asked for in the years, we'd be further down the road. So again, it goes back to the speed at which we can do digital data and ICT will be determined in part by how close we get to £466 million over the next 5 years.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Sorry, I was unaware that you were wanting to come in very quickly, Mr. McNair.
Thanks, Convener. I thought I'd been forgotten about there. It probably is a reasonable enough area to ask a last question on. I wanted to ask about, it's been touched on, I think, in all your answers when looking at the budget overall, but it's just about where local policing sits in the budget in terms of being a priority. Because, I can only speak for myself, but I'm sure I also speak from colleagues, the relationship with local police stations in my constituency is absolutely fantastic. There's two that cover the two different parts of the constituency, and I think it's such a crucial service that they provide to the public, really good relationship with the communities, community groups and stuff like that. So I just wonder where that sits in terms of priority.
From a budgetary perspective, all of our budgets are driven by kind of ground floor up. DCC Wilker runs local policing. He has a huge budget in that area. His requirements, his demands come onto the table alongside all others. What we do from a finance perspective is the kind of technical management of that ask, if you like. The Chief Constable's job at that point is to balance all of the demand and risk across all those different areas. And to be honest, the Deputy Chief Constables, Malcolm Graham, Will and Fiona Taylor, for the most part, agree amongst themselves what the balance of priorities should be because they're all highly experienced senior officers who understand all the demands in those different areas. And what comes usually through to the Chief Constable is an agreed operational plan or operational policing requirement, which we then wrap around the technical side of the budget. So it is up there front and centre because one of the key, as you've already said, one of the key requirements for us in setting the policing budget is public confidence. So that's one of the key things that the Chief Constable has to balance against all those other hidden demands of policing in specialist crime and cyber, which aren't as visible but are more present in some cases.
Thanks for that. I think that's useful to get on the record, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. May I thank you all for your attendance today? I think that's been a really useful session, and obviously if there are any follow-up, I think there's maybe some follow-up information that would be helpful for the committee to receive, that would be welcome, and we'll obviously take that into account. So again, my thanks for your attendance today, and we'll take a short 5-minute break before we move on to our next agenda item. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, members. Thank you very much, members, and welcome back to the next item on our agenda. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. Colin Lancaster, who is Chief Executive of the Scottish Legal Aid Board. Thank you very much, Colin, for your written submission. This is available online, and I intend to allow about an hour for questions and discussion this morning with Colin. So again, I intend to structure this session across a number of themes, and I'd like to start with looking at administrative costs. So I'll hand over to Rona Mackay to pick this up.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, or is it still? No. Yeah, good morning. If I could ask about just the general costs, the administrative costs have remained steady for about 10 years, which I guess you could argue that's a real terms cut. Can I ask you if you have sufficient administrative resources to do your job, and what could it do? What could you do with more?
Good morning, and thank you for the question. You're right to observe that things have been fairly static for the last 10 years in terms of the budget figure. Things haven't been static in terms of the profile of the organisation, the staffing mix, the other costs that we incur. What you can see from a more detailed examination of the mix between staffing and running costs is that they've moved a fair bit in the last few years. And specifically, we have reduced our non-staff running costs quite considerably over that period, which has enabled us to maintain our staffing costs despite the fairly flat overall budget. That's really been part of a strategy to move towards digitisation, to try and drive efficiency within the organisation and in the service that we provide externally. Over that period, we have managed to reduce our staff numbers because some of the processes that they'd been engaged in previously were no longer needed to the same extent because of that process of modernisation. And we've been able to reduce some of our other running costs that have been associated with what traditionally was quite a heavily paper-based process. And certainly now, and particularly over the last 18 months, has been entirely digital and online, barring some of our communication with the public. So all of our communication with the legal profession is based on our online systems. So that's enabled us to really change the way we do our work and the cost associated with doing it. So while there have been various periods where things have been tight, I would say, we have, I think, managed to adopt a number of strategies to live within our means and, as I say, to reduce the running costs to enable us to maintain our staffing numbers where they've been needed. So I wouldn't say over the last few years we have felt that there have been things that we should have done or would have preferred to have done that we haven't been able to do purely because of the budgetary position. But we have kept very careful watch on all of our running costs. Our procurement processes have been improved. Some of the systems that we've adopted have given us some efficiency savings there. And significantly, several years ago, we moved premises out of a beautiful and now very expensive Georgian series of townhouses into a publicly owned building at Haymarket. And that changed our cost profile quite considerably because we took effective ownership of that building and we now manage it on behalf of a number of tenants as well as our own organisation. And that's reduced our cost profile quite considerably, so we can generate income from subletting that space, and that's really seen us through for a number of years. Obviously, those kind of impacts peter out over time. And I would say in the last couple of years, things have become that bit tighter. You'll have seen that the allocation for us this year increased for the first time by any significant amount in the last 10 years. And I think that was really in recognition of the fact that we had, I think, exploited all the usual things you might expect a body to do to find savings in running costs, to drive down expenditure, and that without some additional contribution from the government, the PIPs would start to squeak a bit.
How much did your staffing come down? How much workforce do you
The staff numbers over a long term period, we have reduced, I think, by about 25%. I can give you specific details,
just to get an approximate,
but it's around about that. Over that's not just over the last 10 years, that's probably over the last 15 years. As I say, that process of digitisation was one that was started quite some time ago, and we're maybe slightly ahead of the curve there, which has stood us in very good stead.
Great. You've kind of answered my second question, which was about efficiency savings, but you've explained all that in your first answer. So can I move on to the action that you're taking or planning to take in response to your work with the Equality and Human Rights Commission in regard to impact assessments? And does that have budgetary implications for you?
I suppose in a general sense, we're putting more emphasis on our equalities work. We've been doing quite a lot of that over the last few years, building that up. The way that we have approached our work with the HRC is to try and really embed our work on impact assessment into other processes. So rather than treat it as a standalone issue, what we're trying to do is make sure that as we do business improvement work, as we review our policies and our processes and our practices, that we're really building equalities into the heart of that. So while there is some additional work that would not otherwise necessarily have been undertaken or undertaken in the way that it will be associated with that work, most of it is really an approach. So it's a way of doing the things that we plan to do. So there's a major strand of the work is reviewing all of our operational decision-making policies. So how we apply the discretion we're given by the legal aid legislation in respect of applications or accounts. And making sure that we have got clear statements of all of our policies in relation to those, that is translating to clear guidance for the profession and for own decision makers. And as part of the process of drawing up the policies or articulating the policies that have previously been in place, we are conducting thorough impact assessments, we are consulting on those policies, we're seeking input from the profession, from users of legal aid, from others who might have an input to make, to ensure that we are properly reflecting all the needs of people with protected characteristics, as well as being able to clearly state how we do what we do, why we do it that way, what information we need, whether that's from a member of the public applying for legal aid or from a solicitor making an application on their behalf or submitting their account for payment, to make sure that all of that is as clear and transparent as possible. And as I say, the equalities work is built into to the core of that. Another piece of work which we had already scheduled but perhaps given greater prominence is a review of all our people-related policies. So looking at our staffing policies and procedures, and again, just to make sure that all of those are fully up to date and reflect good practice generally, as well as specifically in relation to protected characteristics. And we will be incurring some additional cost in the support that we need to go through that full review process and make sure we have that up to date suite of policies in place.
It does sound quite labour intensive, what you've been describing, and I mean, I would imagine there would be some additional cost, but I guess the most important thing is that you can evaluate it and you can actually evidence it in your work, and you have methods of doing that. So I guess that's the most important thing. Is there anything else you'd like to say about just the general costs and what your budget is?
I think what I'd say there is that improvement work that we're doing, generally speaking, we are using existing staff to do that work. We'll bring in a specialist support where we need it for short periods of time, but generally we're doing it using existing staff. And for something like the Gala project, the project about our guidance on legal aid administration, we're really tapping into the expertise that exists within our operational teams. That inevitably means that they are drawn away from their day-to-day work for some of that, and I think that is maybe where we're starting to feel a little bit of pressure, and that's why the small increase in the budget this year will enable us to look at the resourcing in those teams so that we can do both the day-to-day work, maintain what has been, I think, fairly good performance in terms of the turnaround times that we have and the engagement we have with the public and the profession on legal aid matters, while also really, as I say, drawing on the experience and expertise of those staff for our developmental work. So that's really what we're going to be able to do over this period.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I wonder if we can move on now to, unless anybody else has got any specific questions around administrative costs, I'd like to move on to looking at trends and sort of general trends around legal aid and the sort of numbers of applications granted for legal aid. And we've seen and we've spoken about this in our previous session with you, the trend has been downwards. And while obviously there are reasons, for example, the pandemic for that, I'm just interested in whether or not you think that there are other underlying reasons why we're seeing this downward trend, and also what that might mean longer term for legal aid budgeting and also extending that to the situation that that might present for legal aid firms offering legal aid work.
Thank you. That's a really interesting question, and one that I could probably spend all day talking about, but I'll spare you some of the details. Really, legal aid isn't a single thing, as you'll have picked up from looking at the stats and from hearing the discussion last week and also submissions that you've had. There's a very wide range of different topics are covered, and the trends in relation to those different topics are different. So the overall picture is a combination of the impacts of really quite different things happening in society, in the criminal justice system and elsewhere. So for example, over the longer term, if we look over sort of 10, 20 years, what we can see is a real move within civil legal assistance towards many of the kind of social welfare law categories. So we now see far more advice provided in relation to mental health, immigration and asylum, and housing cases to some extent, but also the big rise in relation to civil legal aid is adults with incapacity. So you can see the immediate impact of changes in legislation that the Parliament has brought forward and new rights that have been created or processes that are required then can stimulate demand for legal aid. So adults with incapacity is our guardianship-based applications is our biggest single category of application for civil legal aid. And obviously 15 years ago, it didn't exist at all. So you can really see how those kind of shifts happen over a period of time. So while that has risen considerably and stayed at a high level, other things have had different trends. The big headline trend is, of course, in relation to criminal legal assistance. Criminal tends to account for 2/3 of legal aid expenditure. That balance has shifted a bit in recent years in that it's less dominant than it once was. And that is largely driven by a 10-year reduction in the number of court prosecutions. So the system being demand-led obviously responds to demand. So as the demands reduce in relation to the number of court actions that are taken, so applications go down, and as a result, the number of cases that we then pay goes down. And while I suppose generally what one should celebrate the fact that if crime is down or there are fewer prosecutions or people requiring assistance, that would seem to be a good thing. For those providing the service, I suppose it's business levels that then fluctuate. So what we can see over that 10-year period is that the amount of business available to be done by those firms, particularly those who specialise in criminal work and might find it harder to, if you like, divert capacity into other areas of business, will have been fairly significant. It's a 35% reduction in prosecutions over that 10-year period. It's a 32% reduction in criminal legal aid expenditure. Those things will not be without their impacts on those who are delivering the service. I think it's also important, and I know that you'll also be aware of this because you've had submissions from firms. A lot of firms are very small. I think about 70% of those providing criminal legal assistance have two or fewer solicitors providing criminal legal assistance. Perhaps their ability to respond to changes of that magnitude will be quite difficult So they may find it a challenge to flex their capacity or, as I say, to divert into other areas of work. The model 30 years ago was of the generalist high street firm who would be doing a bit of criminal work, a bit of family work, a bit of work for the local community, for local businesses. And those things would maybe ebb and flow in a way that could be managed alongside each other. But the move towards specialisation, particularly small criminal-only firms, maybe leaves them vulnerable to those kind of fluctuations in the market.
Thank you. And that maybe covers my sort of follow-up question, which was really around looking at how those, in particular, specialist criminal law firms might need to change their model of practice, perhaps, and what budget considerations might need to be taken into account in order to allow that to happen. I don't know if there's anything else you want to maybe add on that.
I think it's, again, a really interesting question to ask, and it's a really useful one to be discussed. I think there's a challenge in the discussion around legal aid, which is all about fees and spend, and there's less focus on the delivery. And as we said in our submission last week, the delivery is good. You know, we've got a lot of really committed solicitors up and down the country delivering a great service on behalf of their clients in difficult circumstances, and particularly in the last 18 months in very difficult and changing circumstances. So I think that's really important to recognise. But the structures within which those services are delivered are not, they're in no way dictated by or required by the shape of the legal aid system. So any discussion around different ways in which firms could structure themselves, different ways in which they could mix their business or in which they could maybe work together at a local level or across the country, are really beyond the scope of legal aid policy per se. But the impacts of those kinds of issues very much then result in the discussion focusing on fees and income levels for firms. So I think Mr. Green, I think you raised the question last week about whether an immediate increase in fees would solve the problems that were being described, and it's not for me to say whether there should or should not be an increase in fees, but I think a number of the issues that we see, the things that we hear about in the evidence that you've been given by firms, the things that we pick up in our discussions with them, some of those are structural. Some of those are about business models. Some of those are about the professional structures or training models or the ways in which firms can deliver their services. The way in which, as a public service, this is really unusual in that it relies for its delivery on hundreds of small firms competing against each other at a local level for business rather than coordinating their services to ensure the client needs are met in the most efficient or effective or way that can enable them to, yes, derive fair remuneration for the work that they do in a way that is cost effective for the taxpayer but delivers high quality services to the public in a way that's predictable, understandable and accessible. Mm-hmm. This is not a debate that I think we could possibly resolve today, but I think it's a really important discussion to have.
Thank you very much. That's a really helpful response. Russell Finlay, you're wanting to come in?
Yes, please. Thank you. How are you doing? Just going back to that point about local firms competing for the same pot of money effectively, and some of what we heard previously from Scottish Women's Aid about a lack of specialist solicitors in respect of these types of offences involving women being victims. Do you see an increased move towards more direct employment of solicitors by the board as a likely direction of travel to help resolve that? Is that something that you're actively seeking to achieve? Or really, let's face it, are you up against the resistance of the law firm and their lobby who are pretty hostile to the idea?
it's as I said last week, it's not for us to decide how big or small or where public defenders or on we do have civil employed solicitors as well in the Civil Legal Assistance Office. We can't decide how many there will be or where they will operate. What we've observed is that a more varied range of tools might be helpful in addressing the range of needs that might present and in designing services to provide more of an assurance that services will be there when people need them. That question of competition is a really interesting one, because PDSO has from the outset been seen very much as additional competition for the private bar. So both the private bar as a whole and individual firms in the areas where PDSO operates. It was part of the original expansion plan for PDSO when we went from one office to 3 to 7 following the early evaluations, that the way in which PDSO would operate would try to minimise the impact of their presence on any individual firms. So where we have a PDSO in Dundee, for example, it was set up to cover the courts in Dundee, but also in surrounding towns. So that, if you like, its impact on competition was not focused entirely on Dundee. The Edinburgh office also services Livingston, Sheriff Court, our Falkirk office services Stirling and Alloa Sheriff Courts, to kind of spread that. Now, you can debate whether that's the most efficient way of structuring it. In some respects, what that means is that our public defenders have to cover a lot of ground to deliver their business. And if you were setting up a business and there was sufficient business to be had locally, you might be better focusing on your local patch. But that's not how it was set up. So there are different ways of doing that. There are different mixes that could be possible. As I say, it's not for us to say whether it should be 5% as it is at the moment, or 10, 15, 20, 30%. But there could be scope for both that and different ways of securing the services of private solicitors. So rather than it all being, at the moment, essentially, any firm which wants to provide criminal legal assistance can register with us. There's a fairly low bar for entry. That's not to say there's a low quality bar. It's just to say that the requirements for entry are not particularly onerous. And as a result, any business which wanted to move into criminal legal aid work in any particular part of the country could simply do so. And there's no overview possible or intervention that's possible if that looks like it might actually oversaturates a local market or draw resource away from another area.
Sure. Just a very quick follow-up. Just if I understand it correctly, in order to make any sort of radical changes to structure, it would require political direction. So on the basis of the structure as it is, have you had any thoughts towards creating specialist legal provision to deal with what's been identified as being a particular problem around domestic crimes?
Sorry, what has happened to create, or what could happen?
Well, is it something that you're exploring or have explored, or creating a specialist provision within the framework that you already have?
Yeah, I mentioned last week some initial discussions that we'd had with Rape Crisis Scotland, and the Law Society were also involved in those discussions, looking at the scope, even at present, for advice to be provided to complainers in sexual offence cases, particularly where certain applications were made for the leading of particular types of evidence, the rights of those complainers in those cases to make representations in relation to that evidence. I also mentioned Lady Dorian's review, which looks at expanding the potential for complainers to participate in the process or different aspects of the process. And obviously, for that to happen, there would need to be support provided, including funding for that support. So there's a question as to whether that would best be provided by criminal defence solicitors, who obviously have a clear understanding of the way in which these proceedings may unfold, the issues that may be discussed in court and what it might mean for a complainer, or whether it's somebody with experience in civil matters who might, for example, work in the area of domestic abuse. So there might be different ways of doing that, but we've had those initial discussions to see whether, using the fact that PDSO is a separate service, we could try something out, really explore what service would work best, how to get people in touch with that service, whether that's by referral from, whether it's Women's Aid or Rape Crisis or other organisations which might be assisting complainers in those cases, whether it would be notification by the Crown if an application was made to lead certain evidence. So we could try out those things and then use that as a basis for saying, actually, there is a thing here. It does work with criminal defence agents. There's scope here for it to be effectively a commission service that could bring in the private sector. Because at the moment, everything the private sector does in a legal aid case is defined by the Act and regulations, the things that they will be paid for doing. Other activity that's not directly associated with the case or with a defined form of legal aid would have to be thought of separately. And it may be that rather than thinking, is there a new type of legal aid or is there a new fee for that, it might be, is there a new service that could be delivered, that could be structured in a certain way, that could be commissioned out, contracted with private firms, delivered through a combination of public-private partnerships, specifically to meet this need as it emerges, rather than using traditional models.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Pauline McNeill. I think you were keen to come in.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. So I know you're heard some of the evidence that the committee have already heard. I just wanted to kind of summarise what was interested me about all of this. So we've heard criminal lawyers and the Faculty of Advocates just talk about the fee structure, about even the Faculty of Advocates are saying that they've upped their average daily cases to 20 from 12, and they still think there'll be a shortage of defence lawyers in the system. But we also heard a lot about the job of a defence solicitor. And I think there's kind of quite an important point to address here. The work-life balance for defence solicitors, we heard. So they have to go to the police station, they have to go late at night. And also I would add into the mix that the vulnerability of a lot of the clients of defence solicitors has to be acknowledged. Well, I suppose that's what I'm asking if you agree with this. So any changes to a system, I wonder if you agree, needs to acknowledge that being a defence solicitor does carry all of these things. And whether you work for the PDSO service, I presume, or your own firm, the job probably is much the same. You're dealing with vulnerable people in the criminal justice system who want a choice of lawyer to be properly represented, to give themselves their best chance to put their case forward. And the hours for defence solicitors are probably something that most ordinary people maybe don't appreciate. I was wondering if you agree with that.
Yeah, thank you. And yes, it is good afternoon now. I think what you've had are some quite vivid descriptions of the work of a defence solicitor, and I recognise absolutely that it's a tough job, and what you say there about the vulnerable clients, I think many of them will have pre-existing vulnerabilities, and then being in a stressful situation in the criminal justice system will maybe add to those or exacerbate those vulnerabilities. So you've got people who are in very difficult circumstances looking for help. And quite often their solicitor is the person who's there for them, the person they trust, the person they have a relationship with, and the only person who they think is on their side. So it's a really important relationship that, and I think it's one that so many of solicitors perform admirably. The pattern of work has changed again over the last period. It's around 10 years now since the Cadder judgment extended rights to advice in police custody, and then the Criminal Justice Act, again 3 years ago, further extending those rights. And in many ways, that change and the impact it has on the way services are delivered has not really been reflected in changes in the practice of criminal defence. It's maybe an additional burden, but the model hasn't really changed, which means that while one might look at that and say, well, here we've got a new situation where we've got a requirement for a 24/7 service, a 24/7 service which is going to be delivered potentially by the same people who are delivering the daytime service, who may be called out to police station at 2 a.m, but may have a sheriff and jury trial the next day. They're a sole practitioner, or they work in a firm with 2 people, so there's not really any scope for having kind of rota there, or having time off in lieu, or substituting somebody else the next day. And I think what happened in 2010-11, and largely also in 2018 when the rights were extended, was defence practices absorbed that work. So they just took on those additional responsibilities. And while we did have some discussion at the time about whether there were different models that could be used to ensure that you don't have to be on call all the time if you're a sole practitioner, you might be able to collaborate with your peers to provide, if you like, the sort of deputising services that you see, that doesn't happen. There is obviously a duty scheme which we manage, where we have duty solicitors who are available, and they're, if you like, on call. And in a busy area with lots of firms of solicitors, you might be duty solicitor 1 week a year. In areas with fewer solicitors, you might be 1 week in two, 1 week in three, 1 week in four. But that means that you're not on call for that work all the time. But for your own clients, the duty solicitor deals with people who don't have a solicitor and who are in police custody, ask for a solicitor, and they'll contact us and we'll arrange that. For your own clients, that service doesn't step in. And that's really where that extra burden comes, because even if you're only on duty 1 week a year, you might be on call for your own clients 52 weeks a year. And I can see that that is a real challenge logistically, as well as from a work-life balance point of view. What we did in 2010 was introduce a solicitor contact line, where solicitors employed by us provide a central telephone service. And that was augmented in 2018 to recognise the additional rights. So we have a team of solicitors who are literally at their phones 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, weekends, public holidays, Christmas Day, Boxing Day. And they're available to take calls from the police for people who are in custody. They'll provide telephone advice if somebody wants a solicitor to attend at the police station, particularly to attend for an interview, then we will arrange a duty solicitor to attend. And if there's none available, then we have, if like, off-shift contact line solicitors who we can call on to provide that service as well. Now, that model was, I suppose, initially resisted. It was, I think, initially regarded as being a grab on new business. But I think over the intervening years, a lot of solicitors came to really appreciate the fact that they were the first line, and if they provided some sort of buffer for the demands of being on call 24/7. But it's not really replaced that demand for individual solicitors to be on call. And I think part of the issue, it goes back to the point about competition, is that solicitors want to be there for their client. They want to secure that client. They don't want the client to be, if you like, left with somebody else in case they stay with somebody else. So the contact line doesn't do casework. So if a contact line solicitor acts for the client will still be the client of the other solicitor come the next day when they appear in court. So it doesn't disrupt that solicitor-client relationship. What I think would be really useful, and again, thinking about different models, different ways of delivering the service, is if the private sector was to look at that and think, could we operate in that way in relation to named solicitor clients rather than just duty clients? Is there a consortium type approach that might enable them to work collectively so that, again, every individual solicitor doesn't need to be on call all the time, but between a group of firms, they could agree who was on call and agree that, you know, those clients would still be the clients of the other firms who are part of the consortium. An idea like that did emerge about 10 years ago, but was roundly rejected by the profession. It came from the profession, but it was rejected by the profession, who I think, again, treated it with a degree of suspicion and hostility. And in some respects, that maybe holds the sector back in being able to think about, are there innovative ways of responding to these new demands that would actually provide a good service to clients, but without the impact on individual solicitors?
Just really aware this is a really important topic, and there are a lot of moving parts in it, but just to sort of keep to time, and cover as much as we can. So back to you.
That was really helpful, I thought. Very quick question, hopefully it's a short answer. I know that you heard, I think you did agree, but you can correct me, that fixing the early plea aspect of fee might be helpful in the whole process. And I wonder if you could put that on the record. And also, given what you've said, in the short term, until we find alternatives and agree some of the stuff or talk about some of the stuff you've mentioned, do you think there should be more immediate uplift in the fee structure in addition to what's happened in order to ensure that we can still provide an adequate service overall for people seeking to be defended in the criminal justice system?
Okay. On the first question, yes, I do agree. And just to be clear, that would be reforming the fee structure to better reward early preparation, particularly where that leads to early resolution of the case. Yep. So I absolutely agree that should be done. That could be achieved through regulations. It doesn't need primary legislative change, and regulations could be in place pretty quickly so that new feeing structure could be available for new cases within months. So I think that would have an early positive impact. In relation to the other question, I think there are two things here. There's one which is about should there be an injection of resource, and the other is about should that injection of resource be enabled by or facilitated by an increase in the actual headline fee rate. Now, as I said in my submission for this morning's meeting, the budget is demand-led. If there are more cases and there's more work done, more will be paid out in terms of fees. So if there's an increase in demand in the short term and that results in more solicitors submitting applications or more solicitors doing work and submitting accounts, more money will flow into the sector immediately as a result of that. Our projection for this year is that we'll return to pre-COVID levels within this financial year in terms of overall expenditure, and that will go up in future years because of the backlog being cleared and because of some increases in demand that we've seen even in the last year. So that will put more money into the sector immediately. On the question of whether there should be a fee increase, ministers have committed to a further 5% increase on the back of the 5% increase that was made in March this year. And the payment panel recommendations, I know there was a statement made last week by the Minister for Community Safety. Further work will be commissioned to look, hopefully quickly, at all of those questions as to whether or not there should be, over and above that 5% increase, a further increase in fee rate.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Jamie Green and then Colette Stevenson.
Thank you and good afternoon. I guess I want to address what seems to be a bit of a contradiction in views as to what the situation is with Scottish Legal Aid. Anyone who follows Scottish Legal News or any of the headlines over the last few days and weeks will see that there's quite a vocal concern from the legal profession about the situation versus perhaps what we're hearing in today's session, which is that the the drop in revenue is simply a byproduct of the drop in demand. But we also know, we heard from Citizens Advice Bureau, said that those seeking legal assistance had gone up over 30% in the last year, but at the same time, I believe the amount of grants paid out had dropped by 27%. Another illustration would be some of the witnesses to a previous panel who said that there are legal deserts in provision in Scotland. There is issues with access to justice being many and varied, and those issues are particularly acute in island and rural communities. So it seems to me that on one hand there's a body of people who say that the fee structure doesn't work, they're not getting enough money for the work that they do, they're not being paid for the right type of work, and people in the real world are not able to access the legal justice and representation that they deserve or want. But on the other hand, it seems to be that the system is saying, well, we only pay out as much as you ask us for. And that seems like a huge contradiction. Why is that?
I don't think it's a contradiction as such, but I can see why it might appear inconsistent. The system is demand-led, and you know that's baked in. So if demand increases, if more people seek help and are given that help, then more money will be spent on that help. Nobody is denied access on the basis that the budget has run out, or you know there's rationing of any sort. So you know that's not how the system operates. What we heard from Citizens Advice, I think, was actually an increase in advice about legal aid rather than an increase in people seeking advice on legal issues. Certainly from my previous discussions with CAS over many years, I don't think they tend to be the first port of call for people who are seeking a solicitor. Most people navigate their way to a solicitor independently. If they're having difficulty, they might go to Citizens Advice. So I think they mentioned a figure of 4,000 pieces of advice last year. So relative to the 100,000 or so who were granted legal aid, it's a relatively small number. So I'm not saying that they haven't seen that increase. They absolutely have over this period. That might reflect challenges people faced during COVID in travelling or accessing physical services, and so they might have been seeking further advice about how they can get help during that period. In relation to advice deserts, this is a tricky one. Over many years, we have a duty to monitor the availability and accessibility of legal services, and we did that through an Access to Justice reference group for a number of years, and we had the Law Society, the Scottish Association of Law Centres, Citizens Advice Scotland, Women's Aid, and many others sat on that group, and the purpose of the group was to ingather evidence about these sorts of challenges so that we could provide an assessment to ministers of whether or not there were particular problems in availability or accessibility of services. And I have to say, all of our reports are published on our website. Generally speaking, we didn't find evidence, and none of the participants in the group were able to give us evidence of systemic problems. There would be isolated problems which they could identify, but nothing that would say the system is not working or there are big issues there. In a couple of areas, we had evidence where we thought maybe there's something that could be explored further. One was in relation to access for those who were deaf or hard of hearing, so we did some work with Deaf Action on that. Another was in relation to housing advice. And housing advice is one which does, on the face of it, appear to be very uneven. We can see good, strong pockets of housing advice, particularly in Glasgow and in areas where there are law centres or where our own offices operate, because we do quite a lot of housing advice for rent arrears and such like. But there are other parts of the country where I think it'd be fair to assume that there are people who experience housing debt. They may be getting help from the likes of Citizens Advice or from Shelter or from specialist housing advisors, but we're not seeing that come through in great numbers of legal aid applications. So in some of those specific areas, we can see that there may have been issues, but overall, the evidence that we had didn't suggest systemic problems, and the evidence that we've gathered from applicants for legal aid is that a very small minority had difficulty finding a solicitor. I think we've quoted in the submission 5% of criminal applicants. Our most recent civil survey was 8% of civil applicants said that they found it difficult to find a solicitor. So generally speaking, coverage appears to be fairly solid.
Okay. I know that last survey was in 2018, yes. So I presume there's another one.
We're running one now.
Running one now, great. And just as a follow-on, I guess the three strings to the puppet here are interlinked. One being obviously the set level of fees, which is out of your control. There are policy decisions taken by governments. The volume of cases that are brought to prosecution, but also the value of the cases, and that's something maybe we haven't discussed. And there's probably no magic solution to all of that, but surely it's the increase of one or more of those factors would increase the level of grants being paid out by the board, and indeed the amount of revenue coming into the organisations that Paul McNeill was talking about, who seem to be on the face of it struggling to survive on the smaller scale of the business sector. So where do you fit into that triangle of getting those up? Not that we necessarily want to be paying out more, but if that's what the right thing to do is, because it's an uncapped system, then so be it. So, you know, something has to give. What do you think is the most likely outcome?
Well, I think what we can see happening in the last 18 months is obviously unusual. I mean, it's been very up and down, but we can see there being a build-up, obviously, of cases in the system in terms of the backlog, which you're very well aware of. But there's also an underlying growth in solemn cases, which we've observed. So during the pandemic year, the number of solemn grants was higher than it had been the year before, and it's still going up. So we do see that growth in demand. The trajectory of those cases, the timescale over which they are seen through, will have stretched, but that is very likely to result in an increase in, it has resulted in an increase in grants, it will result in an increase in activity and an increase in spending. So as I said earlier, we expect to go back up to pre-COVID levels this year and beyond pre-COVID levels in future years, and that doesn't look like it's going to reverse within the next 2 or 3 years. So we expect there to be a fairly significant increase in expenditure. In the course of this year, we expect to spend £30 million more than we spent last year.
Just for brevity's sake, we're running out of time, but do you see your organisation more as a facilitator, public administrator of public money to the legal profession business, or as a consumer-facing organisation? Because the fact that there are so many thousands of people going to Citizens Advice, and we know that many citizens' advice services have been cut or lost recently as well. That in itself is that not a warning sign that people have no idea where to go to seek for advice and help? And do you think you could play a better role in being a much more consumer-focused organisation where people know who you are and know where to come to for advice directly from the body that administers the finance, rather than through the third sector or the charitable sector?
Answer as brief as you can. It's just to let other members come in before we close.
Yeah, Thank you. Fundamentally, we are an administrative body. That is our statutory function, is to administer the legal aid system. Whether that's all we should be is a different question. And I think there is potential, as I say, for there to be different models of provision, different forms of intervention. And there is scope for us or a body like us to take a more proactive role. The system is reactive. Maybe it shouldn't be.
Thank you very much. I'll hand over to Colette Stevenson and finish with Fulton McGregor.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good afternoon. And I wanted to touch upon interim fees that was introduced in light of COVID and because of the backlog in cases. And it was just to see, do you consider that is the way forward, that should stay in place? And just the impact going forward in your budgets, how that will be impacted as well. So I'd be keen to find out a wee bit more about that.
Yeah.
Thanks.
We've had interim fees for quite some time. They were extended for COVID purposes. Certainly, I think from the profession's point of view, it would create something of a cliff edge if the interim fee provision were to be removed, because there'd be a gap, there'd be work they'd already billed, and then they'd have to wait for the end of other cases. So if it, as a result of it bringing forward, changing the cash flow model for the profession, then yes, it would change the cash flow model for us as well, if you like, in that we would be paying more out at earlier stages of the case. So it would, if you like, bring forward expenditure from future periods. At the moment, I don't think that would be an issue because of the interruption that COVID caused. So it's something that the profession has talked about for many years. It's something that we have discussed with them. This is perhaps the best opportunity, having made those changes, to keep them in place in some form or other. They were brought through as emergency measures, and they could be more nuanced, but something that addresses that cash flow issue of solicitors having to wait to the end of the case and carrying costs as they go. I have to say that the take-up of interim fees wasn't as big as we had initially anticipated, and I think maybe that was because the profession wasn't confident that there wouldn't be that cliff edge. So an assurance that that would remain might give them the confidence to start changing their billing patterns, and that would improve their cash flow in a way that I think would support their businesses.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McGregor.
What can be done? I've just got a final question on the project that you're running just now. I'll just call it simply the Gala project, but for the record, the guidance and administration of legal aid. In terms of this project, do you think that it's the work of it is having an impact just now on the effectiveness of decision making and streamlining, and do you think it's having an impact on the experiences of solicitors and their clients who are involved with legal aid?
Okay, thanks for the question. It's an important one because it's a huge piece of work for us and one that's central to our work over the next couple of years. Ian Moyer in last week's panel mentioned the impact of the change to the interest of justice test. That came out of our Gala project, where we looked at how we applied that test, the factors that we weighed, the information we needed, and concluded that actually we didn't need all of that information to be satisfied that it was in the interest of justice where a case was being prosecuted in the Sheriff Court. So we changed our guidance, changed our system back in March, and I think I think Ian Moore recognised last week that has already had an impact there in terms of the amount of information we need to be given and perhaps the speed of some of the decision making. So that is having an impact there. We've launched our consultation on accounts assessment. I think that should have an impact, both in terms of some of the specific policy changes that we're proposing, but also in making as clear as we can how the process works and the tests that we apply, so that we can take some of the heat out of that relationship, because it can get fairly tense, and that should have a positive impact on solicitors, both in terms of their administration and their cash flow, if the result of that is that more of the accounts that are submitted can be paid in full first time, because they are all the charges are valid and they're properly vouched. So that should improve that position. We'll be coming on to consult on means assessment, and that's one which could have a significant impact on the individual applicants for legal aid in terms of the way in which we assess their income in particular. And that might make it easier for some people to satisfy the means test, make the system a bit smoother. It is a very complex test at the moment. It can be very time consuming. So anything that we can do there within the test as it currently stands could lead to an improvement. Separately, that process might identify, suggest a change to the regulations, and that's something that we would then incorporate into advice for ministers.
I suppose the outcome of that, and I have to say that anything that improves access to justice and access to legal aid is crucial. So I welcome what you've said, but do you think that, given this as a budget scrutiny session as well, do you think that by streamlining that process, once these things are working even more fully and better, if you like, that the result might be that more people are getting legal aid than before, and will that increase budget pressures in that respect?
It could. I have to be upfront about that. It could well, it could increase budget pressures on the government, not on us, because, as I say, it's a demand-led budget. But what that might mean is that people who perhaps should qualify, but who find it difficult to go through the process, some people drop out of the process along the way, they should get the help that they need. And if us changing the way that process runs enables them to stick with it to the point where they get a grant of legal aid and they get the help they need, I think that's how the system should be working. So if that results in some additional expenditure, I think that's expenditure that reflects what Parliament intends in relation to the Act and regulations.
I agree, and helpful to get on the record. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Mr. Lancaster, thank you very much for your attendance today. That's been most helpful. If there's anything that you wish to follow up, please feel free to do so in writing, and obviously the committee will take that as that evidence into account. So thank you again, and we'll just take a short break to let Mr. Lancaster leave before we move on to the next item. Thank you.